is the big question, isn't it? Who do you say that Jesus is? And we've been spending quite some time here these last couple of months investigating the person of Jesus Christ so that we could worship him well. And so here we are in church again. It's another weekend, and I'm glad that you're all here, big time. Every week you come, every week you're here, and hopefully somehow that God would speak to you and meet with you and speak to you through a weak messenger, but a willing one. And so that should give you all hope. If you're feeling weak but you're willing, he can definitely use you. Amen? Amen. So we've been studying through the Gospel of Luke because we want to get to know who Jesus is. Can you bring me down a little bit? Thank you. We want to get to know who Jesus is so that we could worship him, if anyone remembers, in spirit and in truth. You remember that? And we want to come into church, and we want to be in a live bunch, and we want to release our spirit out to someone or something that's worthy of that release. You know what I'm saying? We don't want to just paint ourselves up and put cheddar cheese on our head and go to football games and scream for a bunch of people that have no impact on our lives. Let's put cheese on our heads and come in here and scream for Jesus, maybe. We could do that, right? I dare you. I double dog dare you. Someone come in with a cheese on their head for Jesus. We don't have any, I don't think we have any mice in the church yet, although every good church should have a house mouse, right? So maybe a real cheese head would be good. We'll track them in. But anyway, we want to worship Jesus well. And so we've been investigating this Jesus as we go through the Gospel of Luke. We've been in it for, I don't even know, I guess I should have looked, but we've been in it for probably, 7, 8, 9 weeks. And we're here in chapter 6 this week. And so we're going to study through Luke for probably close to a year. But I want to invite you now to grab a copy of God's Word. Don't sell yourself short. Grab a copy of the Bible. If you have it on your device, open it to Luke chapter 6. If you don't have it on a device and you want to read, this is a dig. If you want to read a real Bible, amen, for us old timers, grab a copy of it. And if you don't have one, there's plenty of them all around you. They're in the seat back in front of you. They're on the tables. They're blue. And if you use one of those, we're going to be kind to you. We're going to put many of the verses up on the screen, but just the page number, because we don't want you to be lazy Christians, amen? We want you to dig into God's Word and find it for yourself, right? Don't just listen to me. So we are here in church because we want to change who we are. We talked about this a little bit over the last few weeks, that we don't want to be enamored with this idea of change, which all of us are enamored with that, about maybe becoming something different. We actually want to be committed to changing, right? To be conformed into the image of Christ. That's the task. That's the goal. And we're here every single week so that we can do just that. We're Revolution Church, a sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. And we're a gospel-centered, culture-creating community, bringing beauty to the world. So what are we doing here? We're trying to create a different culture. We're immersed in that out there, right? Immersed in it. And it's pushing us towards things, to do things, to conform. And so we're going to fight that thing. We're going to battle against it. And we're going to try to give you a different way to live. The only way we can do that is to change the way that we think about stuff, right? So I'm going to title the message tonight, What Are You Thinking? What are you thinking? Okay, and we're going to get that out of Luke chapter 6. When I title that, because there's a verse in Romans 12:2. I just want to mention before we dive into Luke. It's Romans 12:2, and it just says to not copy the behaviors and customs of the world, right? That's the culture out there. It's telling you to do some things. Everybody's doing it. Come on, man, don't you want to do it? Everybody's doing it. What, are you afraid you're going to get caught? Everybody's doing it. What, are you afraid your mommy's going to find out? Everybody's doing this. But the Bible says not to do that, but to let God transform you into a new person by changing the way that you think. Right? So the only way we're going to get a new culture around here is to change the way we think about stuff. Amen? So that's why you're here. You didn't come in here just to hear a song. You didn't come in here just to have pizza, although that would have been good. And you didn't come in here just to have someone holler at you for an hour. You came, I know you came. You came because you want change. You came because inside of you there's something that's telling you that's just not quite there. Even if things are good, you know there's something not quite there. And you want something more. You want something different. And that's why we're here. We want to let God transform who we are by changing the way we think. And we're going to study that in Luke chapter 6 tonight. Now, before we jump into Luke 6, I want one more verse for you. And it's an odd verse, but I want to read it to you. It's in 1 Corinthians 13. Now, you can turn there if you'd like. It's probably be advisable if you do so. It's 1 Corinthians 13. Let me tell you a little bit about 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If you have, you've probably heard of 1 Corinthians chapter 13 if you've ever been to a wedding. Right? If you've ever been to a wedding, these are the wedding verses. Whether people mean it or not, they stand up here and commit that love is patient and kind and gentle and it endures through all things, even though 50% of us end up getting divorced. So most of the people don't really mean what they're saying, but that's what they say at the wedding. It's the wedding verses. You all heard it before, right? It's important, though. Love is important. And so it describes to us what love is. Now, if you're reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, after you finish the love section, the wedding verses, you're going to see a section on prophecy, and you're going to see a paragraph on prophecy and speaking in tongues and various spiritual gifts. Are those things important? Say yes, because they are. They're very important. Prophecy is extremely important. Speaking in tongues is extremely important. But here's the thing. It goes on to tell us in that section that although prophecy and speaking in tongues are very important because those are gifts that certain people get from the Holy Spirit to advance the kingdom of God, right? Listen, prophecy is huge. Speaking in tongues is huge. If someone walked in right now and they didn't speak English and they spoke some other language and one of you didn't know that language and all of a sudden, wham, you start speaking that language to them so they could hear the gospel, that would be awesome, right? Also, and this is a highly contested thing, and you can take your position on it, I'm going to tell you mine. The Bible will tend to tell us that there's another tongue, that there's this, and you can call it whatever you want. You can call it angelic, you can call it heavenly, you can call it whatever. Just a prayer, a private prayer language. I believe there is one. But I haven't been given that gift. But I believe that there is that gift to advance the kingdom of God. So those things are very, very important because we want to see the kingdom advance. But it goes on to tell us that even though those things are important, what's the most important? Love. So really this section is not about love. And this section is really not about prophecy and speaking in tongues. It's the Bible's way, it's God's way of teaching us some priorities. We got to think right. Because you walk into a lot of churches and it's all about the gifts. Everything's about the gifts. The first thing that they ask when they walk in, do you exercise all the gifts? Are you a spirit-filled church? Do you have all the gifts in church? Is everyone speaking in tongues? We love each other. What's the most important thing? It's in our name. Love. Love. It's a priority lesson here that God's giving us in this section. He's not saying prophecy and tongues aren't important. He's saying that the most important thing is love. We have a problem with the way we think. And that's what he's trying to teach us here through the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 13. We need to have some priorities. Now, he goes on right after that section, and the next thing out of his mouth is kind of weird, but it's an illustration of what he's trying to point out here to us. And you can read it there in 1 Corinthians 13, right after he says the most important thing is love. Bless you. By the way, I need to apologize. Someone asked me to pray for something, and can I ask you, there's no bad time to pray, right? Can we just do that right now? Because I totally forgot, but I want to honor that. I don't know this person's name, but I ask that you would pray for her. Michael DiGiacomo has a friend whose mom was in a terrible car accident, and she is in intensive care right now in surgery. I don't know the extent, Lord, but we ask as your family, if we have found any favor with you at all, we would ask that you would heal this woman and bring her back to strength and health. Lord, it is not by our power, but by yours that this could be done, but it is just our hearts. It is in our heart right now. You're building love and compassion in us right now for this person that we don't even know. And so we just release that passion and that compassion to you, Lord. It's our desire and it's our belief that you can and will, and you'll heal this woman. We thank you for that. And we ask this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, guys. So, pardon my forgetfulness. So he says, after the love is most important, it's more important than prophecy and speaking in tongues. He says, verse 11, when I was a child, I spoke and thought and reasoned as a child, but when I grew up, I put away childish things. I'll just read on. Now we see things imperfectly, like puzzling reflections in a mirror, but then we will see everything with perfect clarity. All that I know now is partial and incomplete, but then I will know everything completely, just as God now knows me completely. When I was a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child, I spoke like a child. I have six children. I didn't want any children, but God saw fit to change my life and give me six children. So I have Chelsea and Bailey and Blair and Adriana and Jackson and Jameson. So I've got all these kids that I've had in my life over many, many years. And so I am an expert on childish thinking. I am an expert on childish speaking and reasoning. I love them all. They are a treasure from the Lord. And I love them. They're all precious in their own way, but they really are beautiful. I do love them. But I am well-versed. I would dare to say that I'm an expert in this field. I need some letters next to my name because I've been around with these kids, and I've been front seat to the crazy ways that they think and talk and reason. So, for instance, you guys know Jackson. I don't even know. I think he may still be sleeping up there. He just turned 3 on September 19th. I have so many kids, I can't remember their birthday. I think it was this September 19th. So, cute little guy and everything, right? And I'm like, hey, you my little guy? He's like, no, I'm big. You guys have seen him, right? Is there anything big about him except his attitude? He's teeny. He's like the littlest person in this whole church. He's so little. But he's convinced I'm big. That's the way he sees himself. He has no comprehension of when I say someday you're going to be big like daddy. And he's like, no, I'm big. He has no concept of time, right? No concept of it. My little girl Jameson, she's as sweet as can be. I love her. She's convinced that when she always says this all the time too. She says, when I have my own home, I'm going to have 5 dogs and 3 cats and 5 motorcycles. And she starts naming off the color. You know, I'm going to have a pink one for this person, a yellow one for you, Dad, because that's your favorite color. And she's naming off all, you know, this is her reality. She doesn't understand, like, maybe she'll end up doing well for herself. I don't know. Maybe she'll marry some rich guy. I don't know what's going to happen. She might end up with 5 motorcycles, but reality is, here's a bunch of reality before me right here, right? I got 1 motorcycle, and I'm thinking about selling it for the cash. The reality is, that's a high order right there to have 5 motorcycles. Hey, when I have a home, she has no concept of reality. And I hope she does. I hope she has 5 motorcycles, because I hope one of them is a yellow Goldwing for her old man. Do you know, here's so funny. Do you know, and my wife told me that, and they're not here so I could pick on them, Bailey and Blair used to do this, and I never believed it, but Jackson and Jameson do this now. They will fight, like they want to sit on mom's lap, right? And they will fight for a specific knee. Like, I don't even understand, I don't even know how to process that. Like, her knee, I love my wife's legs. I'm just going to say on record, I love my wife's legs. I love both of her knees. I'm happy with either one. But my kids will fight. They're pushing and, you know, for a specific knee. Why? I want it now. I want this thing now, right? And they'll, do you know, my garage, I have a 2-car garage. I love my house. I have a 2-car garage. It's actually not a 2-car garage anymore. It's a 1 motorcycle garage, and the rest of it has been like taken over by these little rugrats. And there's toys everywhere. There's toy boxes with every stuffed animal known to man. There's workbenches, and there's dollhouses, and there's toy after toy after toy. There's probably 1,000 of them in there, if not more. But let me tell you something. If Jameson has this one, Jackson will kill her for it. He will pull gasoline out and light her on fire for this toy. Right? He'll kill her. And you know what? She would do the same thing. And it doesn't matter what the toy is. The one that she has, he has to have it right now. Right? Am I alone here? Every kid has this, right? What is that? They will kill for a toy. I don't get it at all. My daughter Adriana, she's back there. She can't hear me. She's 12 years old. 12 years old, sweet little girl and everything, right? I'll come home from work and I'll walk in the door. She doesn't say hello. When are we eating? Like I have a chef hat on or something, right? So I'm like, I don't know. Mom, when are we eating? And Meredith will tell me. And I'll look back at her and I'll say, you know, depending on the time, you know, I don't know, 15 minutes or so. Oh. It's like I might as well have told her 26 hours is when we're going to eat. Oh, it's forever. And she starts sulking, right? Do I have the only kid who does that? No sense of time. No sense of reality. My kids also, I guess we'll just do this all night. My kids, the little ones, right? They you probably had it too. They have this thing they like to top speed around the living room, right? So, I mean, they just run, right? And now they have a new thing. Now they want me to sit in my seat and high five as they're running, like to count laps or something, right? And so my little boy, he always starts first. And Jameson goes behind him, and she's wild. So when she whacks, she always smacks him in the back of the head, you know. And he's like, "Oh!" And then she cuts him off. It's just this big fun thing, right? But they do this, and they've done enough times where inevitably, like, someone's gonna get hurt. So as they start to run, you know, Meredith being the well, hall Nazi. She doesn't let anybody run, right? You guys know that. So she'll yell out, "Don't run," right? But it's for a good cause, because we've seen it happen, right? That they're just going to fall and they're going to bust their head on something. We have who's got a coffee table with like edges with razor blades on them? All of us, right? They all do. So kids get hurt, but they don't care because they want to run now because it's fun, right? So they run, and then what happens? Off to the emergency room, someone's getting their head busted open. Like, we know, they just don't know. There's this just universal trait in all of children, and it's this: now. Do you agree? Every one of them. I want it, and I want it now. Now, we can laugh at our children. It's fun that we do, and they're awesome. But adults, myself included, you fail in just the same way that your little kids do. You fail just like my three-year-olds. Anyone have a credit card here? Wham. I can't afford that. But with this plastic, I can, for $20 a month. And so we buy more because we want it now. We know what we can afford, but we don't care because I want it and I buy it. Because this little plastic thing allows me to, right? I'm guilty as you. Did you ever hear of an interest-only loan? Come on now, am I the only one? I fell victim to it back just before the bubble started, right? When everyone's buying houses, what did we all do? We bought interest-only mortgages. I couldn't afford that house. But they had interest-only mortgages, so for the first 5 years, I could only pay interest, because I know, in my arrogance, that my house is going to go up in value, and then I'm going to sell it and make all that money. But in the meantime, instead of paying $1,500 a month, which is what the house should bring, I only have to pay $1,000. Guess what? My $250,000 mortgage was soon worth $85,000. Arrogance and stupid. I couldn't afford that house, but I wanted it, and so I bought it. Adultery is rampant in our country, rampant in our church. I want her. I want him. That's what I want right now to please me, the lust of my eyes, the lust of my flesh. I want this, and I'm going to get it with no thought of future cost, no repercussions at all. And our common culture, this culture that we're living in that we're not supposed to copy, it's pushing this childlike mentality of now right down our throats. Microwave ovens, fast food. I used to have, we had 3G on the phone. That was fast, right? And then we had 4G, and now we have 4G LTE because we need it to be faster, right? You guys remember this? Here comes the annoying part. You ready? Oh, yeah. Grease lightning. It was awful. But we thought it was amazing, right? Now we laugh at it. It's not enough for us. We need it now. We need it fast. If you buffer for a second, you want to whip your iPhone against the wall. Although iPhones don't do that, but Androids do. I should know better than to pick on someone. You know, I picked on Mark Hyland a couple weeks ago. First time he's been here in weeks. I picked on him about the Bills, and that next stinking week, the Bills beat the Patriots. Crushed them. I'm bitter. Maybe we need to pray again. Here's one. Well, we have, you know, all this, we have everything that promotes this now mentality. You go to the store, every product has every feature, every color, every size. You can buy a house and choose whatever options you want, and every car has options and features and packages. And you think that any of it's to be nice to you? It's so that you'll buy it right now. Somehow they're going to tempt you, and somehow they're going to push this stuff down your throat so you want it. When I was in the car business, we had a line. See if anyone's ever told you this. If I make the numbers right, will you buy the car now? Anyone ever hear that one before? Yep. It's funny, huh? And you guys still fall for it? Why? It's because they think that this car is going to make you happy? It's because culture is cramming now right down your throat, and we buy it all the time. I have a question for you, and there's only one answer for it. How many in this room, show of hands, have made a decision in their life because they wanted something right now, and they regret it now? Come on, everyone. So then this message is for every single person in this room. Does God have your full attention right now? Full attention. All right, awesome. What's this have to do with Jesus? Have you thought about that yet? What does this have to do with Jesus? What is this, you know, when I was a child, I act like a child, I reasoned like a child, I spoke like a child. What does this have to do with Jesus? 2 Timothy 3:16 said that all scripture is God-breathed. It's authored by Jesus. John 5:39 says that all scripture points to Jesus. So it's authored by Jesus. Its subject is Jesus. And here in Luke chapter 6, we're going to actually hear from the mouth of Jesus Christ, the God-man Jesus. So it's authorship, subject, and teacher all wrapped up in one. Are you ready to hear from Jesus Christ? I am here to proclaim it to you. So we see here in Luke chapter 6, we have this verse 20 through 26. I'm going to read it with you, and I'm going to read out of the New Living Translation. It might not be your translation, but you can read along with me if you'd like, or just listen up. So Jesus is with his disciples. You're going to see in a moment as I expand that he's not just with his disciples, but at this moment, he turns to his disciples, and he says this, God blesses you who are poor, for the kingdom of God is yours. God blesses you who are hungry now, for you will be satisfied. God blesses you who weep now, for in due time you will laugh. Some of your translations will say, blessed are those who are poor, for they'll inhabit the kingdom of God. They'll inherit the kingdom of God. Blessed are those who are hungry. Blessed are those who weep. What blessings await you when people hate you and exclude you and mock you and curse you as evil because you follow the Son of Man, who is Jesus. When that happens, be happy. Yes? Anyone want to leap for joy? Okay, one. For a great reward awaits you in heaven. And remember, their ancestors treated the ancient prophets that same way. He goes on and he flips the other side of the coin. It's not blessed who are, but he says, what sorrow awaits you who are rich, for you have your only happiness now. What sorrow awaits you who are fat and prosperous now, for a time of awful hunger awaits you. What sorrow awaits you for who laugh now, for your laughing will turn to mourning and sorrow. What sorrow awaits you who are praised by the crowds, for their ancestors also praised false prophets. This section is expanded on in a great way in the book of Matthew, and it's called the Sermon on the Mount. Maybe you've heard of it before. Jesus is up on this hill when he's preaching this to these people. But this specific section of the Sermon on the Mount is called in your Bible the Beatitudes. So let me admit something to you. Let me admit my stupidity, and maybe you can admit it along with me and make me feel a little bit better. I never looked up beatitude. I just read it and I said, well, it seems as though that Jesus is listing off a bunch of things that I should have a certain type of attitude about. Right? You should have this attitude about this. Just admit it. Do you believe that that's what it is? You can raise your hand if you think so. You always thought so. So two people and then myself. So you guys I don't know if you have another idea of what it is, or maybe you just don't know. Well, let me just tell you what it is. I looked up beatitude, and I don't think it should be called beatitudes. I think it should be called the beatitude. I think we better describe this section because that's not biblically mandated. This is people naming this, so I can say that. I would never second guess God's word, amen, but I would second guess man's attempt, including my own often. But beatitude is defined as a state of utmost bliss. Let that sink in for a second. So it's the idea of, hey, Stephanie, how's it going? And you'd answer back, it's going great. Try that.
Going great?
Yeah, it's going great. Hey, Troy, how's it going? And you would answer back, it couldn't go better. That's what utmost bliss is. It is as good as it could be, right? That's utmost bliss. So the text that we're reading right here, this beatitude, if you just read this, if you don't study God's word, if you don't study this section and compare it to the entirety of Scripture, and that's why last week we stressed the importance of studying God's word. If you just read this section, you just crack this section open one day like many people do, and you read this section, it would tend to lean you towards believing that utmost bliss, this I'm great, it couldn't be better, can only occur if you're poor and hungry and sad and persecuted. Because that's what it says, right? That's what it says. Adversely, the flip side, it would also lend you to believe that sorrow and pain and suffering and bad, let's just say bad, is promised if you make a good living, if you eat well, if people admire you and think highly of you, because that's what it says, right? I read it. That's what it says. And that's why it's so important for God's people, you, to be studying God's word beyond your time here with me, because you need to understand what this is telling you. It can't teach you that that's the case, that it's only pure utmost bliss when you're poor and hungry and sad and persecuted. Let me share a verse with you from the New American Standard Version. It's Isaiah 48:17. It says, I am the Lord your God who teaches you to profit and leads you in the way you should go. Teaches you to profit. Does he want you to be broke? Is that his desire, that you would be poor? Happiness is found if you're poor. Blessed are those who are poor. But he teaches us to profit. If true blessing comes from those who are poor and hungry and hurting and sad, why did he have Moses working? Why was Moses working as a shepherd, providing for his family, for money and food and shelter? Why would he do this? Why would he have David working, providing money and food and shelter and all the necessary stuff for his family as a shepherd? Why would Jesus himself, I think it's in Mark chapter 6, it says that Jesus was a carpenter. Why would Jesus himself, who says, you know what, happiness, utmost bliss is found if you're sad and poor and hungry and persecuted, if Jesus was working, making a living, providing for the needs of his family? Why would the Apostle Paul be working as a tent maker, providing for himself so he could have money and provision for his family and his loved ones? Why would he do this if we're supposed to be poor? Let me do me a favor and keep your finger in Luke chapter 6 and go with me to Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20, I want to read a couple of verses to you. This is about Paul. This is what Paul, he expands upon this thought, talking about his own life. In verse 34, he says, 20 verse 34, "You know that these hands of mine have worked to supply my own needs and even the needs of those who were with me, and I have been a constant example of how you can help those in need by working hard." You see, so he's left a reputation about himself. He says, look at my reputation. Look at my example. Look what I have done. I have worked hard to make a living. I've worked hard to make some cash. I've worked hard to have some food for not only me, but for my loved ones and people that are in my world. I want to help people, and I've left an example for you so you can see it. He also says, let me also take you to 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. He expands again on his own life. He can only speak of his own work ethic, I'm sure, right? So this is what he says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, starting in verse 6. You can read it. I hope you do. He says, "And now, dear brothers and sisters, we give you this command." This is a command in the name of the Lord Jesus. So just imagine for a second that Jesus Christ is speaking this out of his mouth to you, okay? To you. "Stay away from all believers who live idle lives and don't follow the tradition they received from us." What's the tradition that they received from him? We just read it. Don't live an idle life. Work hard. Make a living. Provide for yourself and for people around you and help them. That's the example that he set, right? We just read it. So that's what he's saying here. He says, don't live idle lives, but follow the tradition that you received from us. "For you know that you ought to imitate us. We were not idle when we were with you. We never accepted food from anyone without paying for it. We worked hard day and night so we could not be a burden to any of you. We certainly had the right to ask you to feed us, but we wanted to give you an example to follow. Even while we were with you, we gave you this command: those unwilling to work will not get to eat. Yet we hear that some of you are living idle lives, refusing to work and meddling in other people's business. We command," a suggestion? No, command. We command such people in the authority of Jesus, and urge them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to settle down and work to earn a living. So making a living and eating well and having a reputation as such are important. Proverbs 22:1 says, "Choose a good reputation over great riches. Being held in high esteem is better than silver or gold." So we know that Jesus is not teaching us here in Luke chapter 6 that happiness isn't just being poor and hungry and hurting and persecuted. That's not where happiness is found. And so we have to examine this. What is Jesus trying to teach us? And that's the reason for this message series, is to find out who Jesus is, to find out who Jesus isn't, to find out what Jesus did, to find out what Jesus taught, so it's not speculation, so that your truth can be amped up, so that your spirit can be amped up in worship. Truth amplifies spirit. Amen? And so we need to find out what Jesus is really teaching us, and I'll offer this to you. The first thing I think that this is teaching us is that Jesus teaches us that the gospel is not a prosperity gospel, and it's not a poverty gospel. It's a gospel of grace. That should get an amen. Amen. It is not a prosperity gospel where everyone is promised that if you give your life to Jesus and make sure you give the televangelist enough money, that you'll be happy and healthy and wealthy and everything's going to go great. See, that gets a lot of grief. That gets a lot of pushback in our world, although a lot of people buy into it. That's not the truth. But what people do in our sinful natures, we take that and we know that it's wrong, so we go to the opposite end of the spectrum, right? And you'll see book after book in the Christian bookstores talking about poverty gospel, that if you're a Christian, you really shouldn't have anything. You should give it all away. Listen, not everyone's Francis Chan, yo. It's not happening that way. He can give it all away. That doesn't mean you have to give it all away. Doesn't mean you have to live in a junky house because you've given everything away to everybody else and you have nothing. That's not the gospel. The gospel is the gospel of grace. It'll be two things. That's the first one here. Just look at the text. Look what it says. God blesses you who are poor. God blesses you who are hungry. God blesses you who weep. You got to get this. Not every single person is being spoken to here. Do you understand? He's talking to those who are poor. He's not looking at the disciples and going, okay, disciples, you have to be poor. He's looking at the disciples. He's saying to the group of people, saying, you amongst you. So he's speaking to this group right here. You're disciples, I hope. And he speaks to us, he says, listen, some of you may be poor and some of you may be rich, but don't worry about it. It's all good if you're poor now. Don't worry about it. I got something better coming. Just sit tight. Those of you who are poor, those of you who are hungry, this sermon is preached to his disciples. He's talking to the disciples. And he's saying, some of you are going to be poor, and some of you are not going to be poor, but it's okay. It's okay. I'm a disciple. I'm just going to tell you that. I'm a disciple of Jesus Christ. I have been saved by Jesus from myself, my sin, from the American dream. I have been saved from all that crap and saved from a religion that was going to put me straight into the pit of hell because I knew nothing about Jesus. He went to the cross for me. I want to live for him. I want to die to myself so that people can look at me and they can see Jesus Christ when they encounter me. Like, I'm taking his word seriously. I'm reading it all the time. I'm studying it. I want to know it. I want his will here on earth as it is in heaven. That's what I want, right? I am telling you, I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I'm not saying that in arrogance. He saved my heart, and I want to live for him, and I want that for you as well. But maybe some of you are not. I don't know. You see, if you look where we just read, if you just look up just a little bit in the paragraph just before, it says that Jesus was with a bunch of people, right? It says when they came, he went, this is so cool, he went up on a mountain, and he prayed all night. All night. I can't even pray 5 minutes. All night he prayed because he's about to appoint the apostles. It's a big decision. And so Jesus himself goes up and prays to his Father all night to make this decision. It's a big deal, right? He prays. He comes down off the mountain. He appoints the apostles. It says, when they came down from the mountain, verse 17, the disciples stood with Jesus on a large level area surrounded by many of his followers and by the crowds. That's important. See, I'm a disciple of Jesus. I want to be nothing so that people can see him. I want his will in my life. I want his kingdom to come, right? I want his word buried in my heart. I don't want to sin against him anymore. I want to see his church explode across the continents. I want to see it, right? That's what I want, but not everyone's like that. Look what he says. He says there was his disciples, and then there was his followers. You know, the people that are just kind of following along because they're just kind of curious to see what they could get out of Jesus. I need something, so they follow the crowd, hoping to pick up a scrap. I need something from you, Jesus. I don't want your will in my life, but I want what you can give me. And then there's the crowd. See, there's three groups of people. There's just the masses that have no clue, right? They've heard about Jesus. They're just kind of curious. What's this guy all about, man? What's going on? I see all those people. So let's just go over here. Everyone's going over here. Everyone's sitting on this side, so I'll sit on this side. And they just, that's the crowd. They're just kind of curious. Then there's the followers. They want something. But then there's the disciples. And what I would like to see here is a church filled with the disciples of Jesus Christ that are imitators of Jesus and not just followers to look for something, but like they set aside their selfish endeavors and they pick up the cross and they follow Christ and they study His Word and they treasure His Word and they love on people in His name and they're praying all night. I mean, I would love to have that. Can you imagine a church like that? I can. That's what I see. Can you see it? I want you to start seeing that. That's what this could be. Not just crowds, but disciples of Jesus Christ. And He's preaching to these people right there. And some of you are going to seem to struggle, and some of you are going to seem to not. And all of it, no matter whether you're struggling or not, is all God's grace. And that's a tough one to stomach, but it's true. Grace is just what He decides to bring into your life. Unwarranted. This is what I want for you. This is what I'm going to give to you. It's God's grace. We falsely think that grace is just stuff that we think is good that we didn't deserve. God's grace is His decision to bring whatever He wants into your life. And some of you will be poor, and some of you will seem to just excel financially, and things will go well. Jesus said in John 16:33, in this life you will have trouble, but to be of good cheer. For I have overcome the world. Peter said in 1 Peter 4:12, don't be surprised by the fiery trials that you're going through as if something strange were happening to you. See, disciples, it's not always going to go well. We have to have a correct view of our salvation status. It's not I'm saved and everything is awesome. I want that for us. I mean, I would want that. Who wants that? I want that, right? But it's just not that way all the time. So we can either want it, and it sounds good, and be completely disappointed. And when He doesn't deliver, you throw Jesus to the curb, or you can truly understand who He is and what He's done and embrace it whenever it happens. That's where you need to be. It's not always going to go well. Sometimes it's going to be rocking, but it's not always going to be. And we need to embrace both of them. As God's grace. There's all kinds of different people in the kingdom of God. Walk into any church on any weekend, you're going to see a room full of people. Some are going to be believers, and they're going to be disciples. Some are going to be followers. Some are going to be the crowd. But there's going to be some that are Christians and some that are not. And some are going to be rich and some are going to be poor. Some are going to have a rocking family and the marriage is going well. And some of them are falling apart, but they're all Christians. There was Lydia, who was the merchant in Philippi. She was the merchant that was a very successful woman selling expensive purple cloth. And she was making a killing doing it. And she's a Christian, a wealthy person. There was John the Baptist. He lived out in the wilderness with nothing. He was wearing animal skins and eating bugs for lunch. And then he was beheaded. Christian, right? There was a demon-possessed slave girl, Christian. There was a jailer, chef, Christian. There was a Roman centurion. There was an important soldier in the Roman army, and he had people underneath him. He was an important man of position and power, right? And he was a Christian. Fishermen, you know, everyone loves a good fisherman if they can bring them to the good fishing hole. So I don't know if they were respected or not respected. Probably some were and some weren't. But, you know, educated, non-educated, maybe making a good living, maybe not making a good living. Christians. Tax collectors, they were wealthy people, but they were hated. So they didn't have a whole lot of friends. So they had some goods and bads in their life, but they were Christians. Prostitutes. They were prostitutes that became Christians, right? Things weren't going good for them. Let's just face it. Being a prostitute's not a good life. But they're Christians. Rabbis. Educated religious folks and doctors. Luke was a doctor. Christian. All kinds of different people. Christians. Some had it good and some not so good. But let me tell you something. There's a sovereign God who sits over all of creation. And he reigns on the just and the unjust. And he gives good gifts to whom he pleases. And he's I hate to use the word manipulator, but he's a manipulator of situations and meetings and situations and circumstances and all. He's doing all this and he's working stuff out for his glory. Do you understand? All of it is done with one sole purpose, and that is to drive people back to him. That's what he's doing. And no matter what he's doing behind the scenes that you don't know about, you think they're good, you think they're bad, but he's doing all this for as he sees fit for his glory, because a growing population is a king's glory. And so he's driving people back to himself through these situations, and you think they're good and you think they're bad, but they're all God, and he's working it out for your good. This is his grace in action and on display, all for him. No matter what the situation is, that's God at work. Listen, circumstances and situations and good and bad relationships and good money and bad money, all that kind of stuff, doesn't make any difference what it is. None of it negates God's grace. Listen, no matter what the list is, every single thing on it is God's grace. Do you get it? It is God's grace. And he's going to use it, if we think differently about it, to drive you back to him. And that's the goal here. That's what Jesus is doing. It's not a prosperity gospel. It's not a poverty gospel. It's a gospel of grace. Here's the second thing that Jesus is teaching us. This gets it right back to the beginning. He's teaching us to stop thinking like a child. Right here in this text, this is exactly what he's teaching us to stop doing. Look, how many times does he say now? God blesses you who are hungry now. God blesses you who weep now. Happiness now. Prosperous now. Laughing now. The problem is that we're focusing so much on the now. And you got to remember something. And this is an ethereal thought, but you got to embrace this thing. Where you are right now in the situations and everything that's going on right now should not be paramount in your thinking. You are not from this place. If you have been saved, you are a new creation. The old has died. Behold, the new man. You're a citizen of heaven. You're not a citizen of this earth. You're just passing through. And you have to have this perspective, or you're going to go crazy worrying about what's going on in your life. Look at Philippians chapter 3. Please do me a favor and turn there. Philippians chapter 3. Verse 18 through 20, I want to read it with you. As you were focusing too much on this, on the here and now and what's happening right here, and it's affecting us so much. So here's Paul, loves his people as I love you, and I can relate to him here, what he's saying, but he's just pouring out to these people. And he says in verse 18, "For I've told you often before," that reminds us that he often will repeat himself, and some people might think that that is boring, but that's just great teaching, and it's love. If you haven't gotten somewhere yet, and I see it in you, and he sees it in them, he wants to repeat something because he wants what's best. I've told you often before, and I'll say it again with tears in my eyes, that there are many whose conduct shows that they are really enemies of the cross of Christ. Now, you got to understand, he's speaking to a church. Okay? That's why there's tears in his eyes. You know, and I feel what he's saying, because when I get to know you and I love you and I see you do something that's just so awful and detrimental to your health, to your well-being, to your family, to your career, to your walk with the Lord, I get it. Tears. I get it. He says of these people, they are headed for destruction. Their God is their appetite. They brag about shameful things, and listen, and they think only about this life. here on earth. So that's what they think. But I'm persuaded of greater things for you guys. And I think he was too. And he said, but we are citizens of heaven where the Lord Jesus Christ lives. And we are eagerly waiting for him to return as our Savior. Are you eagerly waiting? I mean, do you want that? You got to ask yourself that question. Are you eager to see Jesus Christ return? If he came back in your present state right now, would it be a good day for you? I love you enough to challenge you with that. I'm not going to fluff it up here and tell you if you do this, you're going to make a little more money. I'm telling you that there's things that are more important than that. There are eternal things. We got to get our eyes off of the temporary and onto the eternal. If Jesus Christ came back, are you eagerly awaiting this thing? Like, I can't wait for Jesus to come back because that's where my mind is. I'm thinking about that. I'm thinking about that, Lord. I'm not thinking about this stuff right now. I'm thinking about that. And is that dictating your actions, your thoughts, your perspectives, your priorities? Is this what's affecting your life, or is it just the stuff around you that's commanding your attention and driving you to make certain decisions based on what you see here? Horizontal versus vertical. We have to think about these things. Now. And he says he's teaching us that if stuff seems bad now, it's okay because it's going to get better. But the flip side is if everything's rocking right now, you need to be concerned to not be focused on that either. Don't just be, hey man, you know, how's everything going? It's going so good, couldn't be better. It's been rocking for like 10 years now. Everything's going great. The Bible says if riches increase, do not set your heart upon them. And when things are so awesome, we start thinking, I'm invincible, and I'm good, and God has just poured out his blessing on me, and I'm good. Not always that way. My current circumstance, it's the situation, I'm thinking about that. It's dominating my thoughts. It's dominating my day. I'm dreaming about it at night. I want her. It's now. I want him now. He's handsome and he speaks to me and he cares about me and he doesn't anymore and she's the one I really wanted and I want this right now, so I'll charge it. I can't afford it, but I want it and my struggle right now and the thing that's causing me the most pain right now, and I'm not just talking about physical, any emotional, mental, financial, relational, these are the things that I'm constantly dwelling on. I'm worried about this stuff, and that's what I'm thinking about. The problem is that you're staring at now. And that's not what God wants. God doesn't want you to live that way. We're staring at the now. You guys all know Greg right there? The rumor is, well, I shouldn't say it's rumor. I got to fess up. He makes really good fried chicken. I mean, I'm not going to lie to you. See, one night he actually brought some in for me. So that's his reputation. He makes this incredible fried chicken, right? And one night he brought in some extra fried chicken and he gave it to me. And y'all were out there eating whatever was here. It was good stuff. But I come walking out of my office and I'm hammering on a drumstick. And everyone's like, what the heck, dude? And I'm like, privilege, dude. I mean, I don't know. He gave me a couple pieces of chicken and it was good. It was good. Anyone like fried chicken up in here? Anybody? Right? So let me ask you a question. If Greg came up here right now and said, listen, next week I'm going to make fried chicken for everybody. You're going to have a lot of new friends before you leave tonight, brother. And one of them is probably not going to be me because you're going to be mad at me for saying this. But but if he said, I'm going to make fried chicken for everybody. And not only that, but I'm going to make some mashed potatoes too. And stuffing. And biscuits. Woo! Right? I'm going to have it all here. Y'all would like that, wouldn't you? Come on, right? And dinner's going to be served at 6 o'clock right here. If you knew that, how many of you would willingly, at 10 till, honestly, just start hammering Doritos and cookies and soda? So why are you doing that with God? He has so much more for you, and you're worried about the here and now. He's like, listen, 15 minutes from now, you can have this amazing banquet. And you're trying to satisfy yourself with right here, right now, by eating these lame Doritos when he's got fried chicken, right? But we do that with God. So worried about right here, right now. I'm hungry right now. I need to eat some Doritos right now. Just wait a minute, dude. Fried chicken. When I was in elementary school, I had this gym teacher. His name was Mr. Howie. He was a good dude. And Mr. Howie, we had all kinds of different activities that we would do, but there was one, we had the balance beam. Anyone ever do the balance beam, right? Balance beam. So we'd go on the balance beam, and if you're a kid, I don't know if you remember this, but if you're a kid, well, I'll do it this way so y'all can see. If you're a kid, you get on the balance beam, especially for the first time, you're like this, right? And you're looking right here, and you're just trying to get one foot in front of the other, and soon you'll be walking across the floor, right? But you'd fall, because you're looking right here where the trouble is. Here's the trouble. I got to try to make this work, right? Here's the trouble. What did Mr. Howie always tell us? Look at the end. Stop worrying about right here. Stop worrying about the problem, and start looking at the solution. There's the solution right there. That's the goal. That's where you need to get, right? You know who's here at the end of the balance beam? It's Jesus. He's going, come here. And we're too busy with our face down looking at today. And all the while, Jesus is going, come here, son. Come here, daughter. And we're ignoring him, looking down at the balance beam. And that's what we do with our lives. And that's what we do with Jesus all the time. How do you fix your eyes on the end of the eternal balance beam? How do you do that? Jesus was before creation. He wasn't a created being. Before there was, I am. And he was there before creation. And the Bible tells us, and it's true, that he will never, ever die. So he's eternal, right? And this eternal being came down, put on flesh, and died so you can also have this same eternal life. And since you've been raised to new life, and since the Bible is very, very true, it says that you are co-heirs with Christ. Do you ever think about that? What is Jesus going to inherit? Everything. He's the king of every single thing, right? And the Bible, listen to me, I'm not a prosperity guy. The Bible says, the truth, God's word says that you are a co-heir with Christ of everything. That's He's trying to serve you a fried chicken dinner, and we're macking on Doritos. We're satisfied with so little because we're worried about right now, the here and now all the time. We tend to focus on the temporal instead of the eternal, and it just doesn't make sense. Listen, I'm guilty of it too. I'm just preaching to you. Anyone ever hear the expression, don't be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good? Anyone ever hear that one before? Raise your hand. I need to see hands, seriously. So don't be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. You've heard that, right? Sounds kind of Christian, right? You don't have to say whether you agree or not. I'm going to take a poll or anything, but I just want you to ask yourself, do you agree with that? You know, that person that's, no matter what you say, no matter what's going on, it's always praise God, and he's quotes scripture and all this kind of stuff, right? And it kind of drives you crazy. So you're like, don't be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. Kind of sounds Christian, doesn't it? But Thank you. But here's what God's word says. Since you have been raised to new life, I just said that he died that you would have life and you're a new creation. And he says, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not the things of earth. Could it be any clearer than that? Right? What are you supposed to be thinking about? The here and now? Or are you supposed to be sitting there thinking and contemplating of the realities of heaven, a place where God, Jesus said that he was going to go and prepare a place for you, and when the time is right, he's going to come back, and he's going to get you, and he's going to bring you there with streets of gold and no more tears and no more pain and no more suffering, right? That's where it's going to be. And you need to be thinking about that and so excited about that all the time, even in the soup, that you're eagerly awaiting him to come because that's what you want, because that's where you're thinking. Are we thinking about that? Maybe when you come to church? But what's he saying? Set your eyes on that. Don't just think about it when you come here. Like this is some magical room. Ooh, that's the Holy Spirit room. He's out there too. Right? There's nothing special about this room. It's a nice joint and the seats are comfortable, finally. And the air conditioning works. Praise God. Yeah. It was cold when I got here today. It was awesome. But this, too, is all going bye-bye. Set your eyes and your thoughts and all your thinking on the realities of heaven where Christ sits at the right hand of the Father. Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, let us run with endurance the race God has set before us. Do you have a race set before you? Did you know you're running a race right now? And you might not feel like you're running really, really fast, but there's a finish line. And for some of us, it's a little bit closer than others. And for some of us, it's a lot closer than we would like it to be, but we're running a race. And how do we get to the end? Like, not freaking out about this world and can't wait for Jesus to bust open the clouds and come down and save us. How do we get to that place with rejoicing? You read on, by setting our eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. So that's why Jesus here in Luke 6, he's saying, stop thinking about this stuff now. Stop thinking about this stuff. Stop thinking about this stuff. Set your eyes on me. He doesn't just say, look at me on Saturday or Sunday, but fix your eyes. That means never take them off of me. Jesus came from heaven, right? Fully God as a visual aid for us. He is God, but he came down as a visual aid. He said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So Almighty God has given us, he's actually given us in his grace a glimpse of what heaven will be. And it's not so much the place, but it's the person of Jesus Christ. Where Jesus is and you're in his presence is heaven. And you can enjoy that heaven right now. Do you understand? Jesus is heaven. It is a place. We'll go somewhere, but it doesn't matter how awesome it is if Jesus ain't there. What makes it so awesome is not the streets of gold, it's that the streets of gold lead to his throne where Jesus is. That's what makes heaven awesome. Let me bring the band back up so we can worship this awesome Jesus, please. Listen, we got to get our eyes off of our problems, for he has overcome the world, and he has conquered the grave. We got to get your eyes off of gathering and accumulating stuff and riches and praise here and now. God's word tells us to not store up treasures here on earth where moths and rust destroy them, and where thieves break in and steal. But to store your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust do not come in and destroy, and where thieves cannot come in and steal. But this is the most important part. Listen up. Wherever your treasure is, there too will be your heart. There too will be your heart. Will now, we've all admitted it, Will my choices of now affect my then? Will my accumulating and acquiring of stuff and gold and women and men and prestige and houses and cars, all these things that we think we need that our culture pushes down our throat, will all of this cost me way too much then? Where are my eyes? Loved ones, where are your eyes? Are your eyes on your problem or on your provider? Are your eyes on your stuff or on your Savior? Are your eyes on your gold or on your God? Where are your eyes? Let's pray and we'll sing to Jesus. Father, I am painfully and sometimes shamefully aware of where my eyes are. And I repent of that. My joy should come from the Lord, not from people, not from this church's success and ability to reach the world, not from my wife or my children or my friends or my bank account, my house, my nation, whatever it is, Lord. I'm a Christian. We're Christians. We're followers of the way, Lord, but we stray. Your word tells us that it is you working inside of us to give us the will and the desire to do what pleases you. And so we confess our sin before you, that we often put our eyes on things that don't deserve it. We often praise things that don't deserve it. But we need to fix our eyes upon you. But it's you that gives us the will and the desire and the power to do that. So that's what we're doing right now, Lord. We're asking you, help us with that. Help us to fix our eyes on the realities of heaven, where you, Lord Jesus, sit at the right hand of the Father. Help us to be a church that is so heavenly minded that we are earthly good. Help us in this endeavor, we pray in Jesus' name.